resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Stand to sing our processional hymn, All My Hope on God is Founded. Almighty God, you judge us with infinite mercy and justice, and love everything you have made. In your mercy, turn the darkness of death into the dawn of new life, and the sorrow of parting into the joy of heaven. Through our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. God has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of his glory in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels to show that the transcendent power belongs to God and not to us. As we acknowledge our human frailty, we call to mind our sins of word, deed and omission, and confess them before God our Father. You raise the dead to life in the Spirit. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You bring pardon and peace to the broken in heart. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You make one by your Spirit the torn and divided. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May God our Father forgive us our sins and bring us to the eternal joy of his kingdom, where dust and ashes have no dominion.
Amen.
Let us pray. Merciful Father and Lord of all life, we praise you that we are made in your image and reflect your truth and light. We thank you for the life of our late Sovereign Lady Queen Elizabeth, for the love she received from you and shared among us. Above all, we rejoice at your gracious promise to all your servants, living and departed, that we shall rise again at the coming of Christ. And we ask that in due time we may share with your servant Elizabeth that clearer vision promised to us in the same Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end. Amen.
The epistle is from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. So, do not lose heart. Even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure. Because we look not at what can be seen, but at what that cannot be seen. For what we can see is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this tent we groan, longing to be further clothed with our heavenly dwelling. For surely, when we have been clothed in it, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan under our own burden, because we wish not to be unclothed, but to be further clothed, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. This is the word of the Lord.
Sad to sing our next hymn, Now is Eternal Life, If Risen with Christ We Stand.
Thank you. raise them up on the last day. Hallelujah. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Very truly I tell you, anyone who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life and does not come under judgment, but has passed from death to life. Very truly I tell you, the hour is coming and is now here, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For just as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to execute judgment, because he is the Son of Man. Do not be astonished at this, for the hour is coming when all who are in their grave will hear his voice and will come out. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Several senior members of the family are, if you'll excuse the expression, getting on a bit. King Charles, Queen Consort, Princess Royal are all in their 70s, but how well they have coped. Part of what I imagine of this ability to keep going on, no matter what, stems from their inner discipline. I'm sure much of that discipline has been taught to them by Queen Elizabeth. We might say then that they have been able to repay some, to some extent, those valuable lessons. We too, when we lose someone close, have to keep going, without of course being in the public eye. It's all the business of organising a funeral, clearing the house, perhaps, and that's always a very emotional experience. And coping with all the legal bits and pieces, probate, bank accounts, and so on. It all has to be done when we are feeling at a low ebb. How are we to cope and find the inner strength required? Let's just go back to the Queen for a moment. One thing that has always putting on of appearances, going along the defender of the faith, or acting out the role of the governor of the Church of England, but not really subscribing to it. No, this was a genuine, lifelong, deep and considered faith. I've heard it said that she would kneel at her bed every night from early childhood through to old age to say her prayers. She was known for her sense of duty to the nation and the Commonwealth, but she had the same sense of duty to God. Now we turn to our Gospel reading, and you'll remember that it began with Jesus' promise. Very truly, I tell you, anyone who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and does not come under judgment, but has passed from death to life. Now, of course, I will not dare to attempt to preempt the will of God, but as far as I can see, Elizabeth II was someone who heard God's word and believed in him. I hope that that idea will be in the minds of the royal families that go through the funeral service tomorrow and on to the interment. And if it is, surely it will help them cope. I hope to keep that thought in my mind as well. Although my sadness will be nothing like theirs, I hope too that if you feel as I do, it will also give you comfort, those words of Jesus. There are so many places, aren't there, in Scripture that can help us cope with adversities that we encounter. And one of those places is surely also our reading from Paul's second letter to the church in Corinth. Might not be as well known as some other Paul's writings, but it is tremendously encouraging. We've chosen for this service by the archbishops, so that we could have heard it last week, but we chose to keep it for this week instead. Like the Gospel reading, it starts with a memorable phrase, so we do not lose heart. Paul then goes on to give us several reasons why this is so. It is therefore an inspired church for this present time when so many of us are feeling down. Let us pray that it can also help the family of our friend Shirley Palm, who died this week, and pray that it can help us when we are faced with bereavement. I love Paul's image of us being in a tent here on earth, but one that we will be placed by a building that is eternal in heaven. A good example, I think, of preaching from things that we know. Paul was attending by trade. He firmly takes the view that the future is better, much better, if we believe in God and attempt sincerely to obey his commands. He refers to us groaning in our tent and longing for that heavenly kingdom, heavenly dwelling. It so happens that I've always liked camping, although I haven't indulged recently. But whenever I have been in a tent, there's always a little bit of me that harks back to the comforts of a decent shower and a kitchen that doesn't produce food smelling of propane or wood smoke. How much more then do we yearn for the infinitely better accommodation that God offers? No, we don't know what it's going to be like. But if we have faith, then we need not fear for the future, for ourselves, and likewise for those who we might desperately miss, our loved ones when they die. We need have no fear for their future. Sadly, many people find faith difficult when faced with the loss of someone close, but paradoxically, when someone prominent dies, people often turn to faith to find solace. I've no idea why this is so, but I do believe that our future is safe in God's hands. and having that faith can be a great strength in difficult times. Actually, that part of me that didn't want to do this has now disappeared. There have been some suggestions that the late Queen might be remembered as Elizabeth the Great. However, there's been a further suggestion that she should be remembered as Elizabeth the Faithful. That's a far better idea to my mind. She was faithful to God and faithful to her vow of lifelong service. May she rest in peace and rise again in glory. And long live the King. Let us cry. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, we bless your holy name for all that you have given us in and through the life of your servant, Queen Elizabeth. We give you thanks for her love of family and her gift of friendship, for her devotion to this nation and the nations of the Commonwealth, for her grace, dignity and courtesy, and for her generosity and love of life. We praise you for the courage that she showed in testing times, the depth of her Christian faith, and the witness she bore to it in word and deed. We pray for our Sovereign Lord and all the royal family, that you might reassure them of your continuing love and lift them from the depths of grief into the peace and light of your presence. O Father of all, we pray to thee for those whom we love but see no longer. Grant them thy peace, and in thy loving wisdom and almighty power, work in them the good purpose of thy perfect will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, Father of all mercies and giver of all comfort, deal graciously, we pray, with those who mourn, that casting every care on thee, they may know the consolation of thy love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now we join together saying, God of mercy, entrusting into your hands all that you have made, and rejoicing in our communion with all your faithful people, we make our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. The peace of the Lord be always with you."
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace. sing our offertory hymn, Abide with Me. It is our duty and our joy at all times and in all places, to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Now we give you thanks, because through him you have given us the hope of a glorious resurrection, so that, although death comes to us all, yet we rejoice in the promise of eternal life. For to your faithful people, life is changed, not taken away. And when our mortal flesh is laid aside, an everlasting dwelling place is made ready for us in heaven. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. Same way after supper he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
Dying, you destroyed our death.
Rising, you restored our health.
Lord Jesus, come in glory.
Therefore, Lord and Heavenly Father, in remembrance of the precious death and passion the mighty resurrection and glorious ascension of your dear Son, Jesus Christ. We offer you through him this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Grant that by his merits and death, and through faith in his blood, we and all your church may receive forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of this passion. Although we are unworthy, through our manifold sins, to offer you any sacrifice, yet we pray that you will accept this, the duty and service that we owe. Do not weigh our merits, but pardon our offences, and fill us all who share in this holy communion with your grace and heavenly blessing. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom, with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, whose church on earth is a sign of your heavenly peace, an image of the new and eternal Jerusalem, grant to us in the days of our pilgrimage that fed with the living bread of heaven and united in the body of your Son, we may be the temple of your presence, the place of your glory on earth, and a sign of your peace in the world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Do you know what this is today? But first of all, some hands of marriage. Published the banns of marriage between Jacob Elliot Larby of the parish of Purford and Bethany Kate Wood of this parish. This is for the third time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why they may not marry each other, you are to declare it. So we pray for Jacob and for Bethany as they prepare for their wedding day. Lord of love, we pray for Jacob and Bethany. Be with them in all their preparations and on their wedding day. Give them your love in their hearts throughout their married life together. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Tomorrow, the church will be open, as usual, both for prayer and reflection. And at 6 p.m. tomorrow, there's a service of evening prayer here at St. John's, which will be the conclusion of our commemoration of Her Late Majesty the Queen. Next Sunday is Harvest Festival. Dry goods may be bought, that's cans or packets of dry goods, for which will go to the food bank and for transform housing. And I think Ross has a message too.
Just a reminder, as you've seen in your notice sheets, this evening at 6:30 we have our monthly gathering, Talk, Think, Pray, which is an opportunity to discuss in an informal setting a topical issue. We don't usually advertise in advance the subject, but one or two people have said that they would find it helpful to know in advance what we'll be thinking about. And so I thought that this evening we would begin at least by thinking about the subject of grief. Perhaps an opportunity to explore some of the ideas which Clive has raised for us this morning. This will be followed by a very short service of compline, or evening night prayer, and that in turn will be followed by a period of silent time for silent reflection, leading up to and culminating with the national silence at 8 o'clock. Do please join us for that if you're able. If you're not able to be here and live near enough, just before 8 o'clock the bell will be rung to signal the start of that period of national silence.
Here also today to meet someone important who has given many years to working with our children's ministry, and that is Mary Blackwood. She's now finally resigning and retiring from her work with the children. She's taught this for many years, and we'd like to come. Or we'd like to stand where you are. Dave has got something for you. Where are you? That's all you want. You're hiding.
Thank you.
years. Thank you very much, Mary. Stand to sing our final hymn.
Thank you.
life everlasting. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.